are the rules for success here in that should we be looking at, and you've disqualified this already, open rate and reply rate? Because if we're getting lots of negative replies, people telling us to bugger off, then clearly we're not having success, even though the numbers might look fantastic. Or is success perhaps calls booked in, or is it, or can we, with modern tools, can we go all the way to deals closed? What should we be doing to judge whether our cold outreach is being successful or is just a waste of time?
Yeah, let's talk about calls first, and then we'll talk about email. So with regards to calls, we have to set benchmarks as to what good is with everything that we do. Otherwise, we don't know. So what is good with regards to benchmarks? And then, of course, what is good with regards to a cold call? What is good with regards to a discovery call? What is good with regards to an email? Oftentimes when sales leaders come to me and they say, are people stuck at writing emails? They suck on the phone. I say, well, do they know what good is? And do you know what good is? And oftentimes the answer is no. When we were in high school, Will, you probably remember when we had to write a paper, our English teacher said, here's the rubric. This is what your paper has to look like in order for you to score fives in each of these categories. And yet in sales, we don't do that. So with regards to cold calls, one of the first things we want to take a look at is connect rate, meaning the percentage of time I actually connect with the intended target. And that has to be around 5.5% to 6% at the lowest side. If you're below that, perhaps your target market can't be reached over the phone. Perhaps your target market, perhaps your database needs to be updated. Perhaps you need to look at other providers, et cetera. So I'd like to see a 5% connect rate. And then when we're actually on the call, if we take a look at the cold call, you can think of the cold call as having four parts. Most cold calls do, they have a four-part thing. You can actually start to measure the drop-off if you use dispositions between the opening, part two, part three, and part four. So someone picks up the phone and they say hello, and you say, hey, well, you're probably going to hate me because this is a cold call. Do you want to hang up or roll the dice? And what we want to see there, and there's 15,000 openers, please don't write, Will, that opener sucked. We realize there's 20 openers. Whatever your opener is, you want to measure it. And 85% of the time, we want a neutral or positive reaction to that opening, like a funnel. So we're going to measure that at 85. If that thing dips below 85, is it your tonality? Do we want to change the script? Do we want to say something like, hey, Will, this is Josh. We've never met, but I was hoping you could help me out for a moment. We want to test that. We want to get that at 85%. Then we're going to go to part two, and we want that at 70%, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we want to take a look at how that is converting down, and you could just set up dispositions to be able to track that in Salesforce, and you can have like a little funnel. People always measure meeting book rate. Of course, connect to meeting book rate is important, and I like to see that at about 15 to 18% as a benchmark as a team. But also, I like positive talk time. What I mean by positive talk time is there's rapport and back and forth on the call, even though the meeting wasn't booked. What that tells me is that although it didn't book now, it might book one day, and the rep shouldn't be penalized for that because they didn't book the meeting. They planted a really great seed. Sure. So I also measure positive sentiment, positive rapport on the call as evidenced by talk time. If the call went on for 5 or 6 minutes, it was positive. The rep was asking really great illumination questions, and the prospect was sharing a lot of information. They were telling a lot of truth. They just weren't ready to commit for whatever reason. I think the rep should get credit for that. So positive sentiment is another one I like to measure.
Cool. So there's three things to go at here. Some of this is objective, but it'll be subjective for the audience in that it'll depend on how big the organization is, how many reps they have, who they're trying to reach. So when you say we're looking for 8% of XYZ, how, just as a rough guide here, because they'll be masked to make things statistically significant, which we don't need to go into, is this 8% if we're experimenting on 100 calls, 1,000 calls, 7 calls? How many calls do we need to do to make a number at least somewhat valid?
100 connections. So 100 connections with the intended target. So the intended target is not a executive assistant. The intended target is not a, I hate this term, but everyone uses it, gatekeeper. 100 conversations with the people that you intended to call. And there's obviously technology out there that can accelerate that. Technology like Connect and Sell, and there's a bunch of them out there that can help you have more conversations per minute. But yeah, obviously not 3 calls. 100 is a really good benchmark to be able to start to get statistically significant data where you can actually start to test scripts and tonality.
Sure. And this leads me
to... something else that I see a lot that might seem blatantly obvious is sometimes people are not strategic about the accounts that they select and the four or five people within those accounts that they select. And so they're not calling best fit. There's always a subset of accounts that are the best fit, and they're not calling the people that have this specific job. And so sometimes a low connect rate, low connect to conversion rate is great script, great messaging, wrong company, wrong person.
Let's make the assumption, Josh, just because if we go for every step, I'm happy to talk to you for 5 hours, but we will literally be here for 5 hours. Let's make the assumption that we've got good data and we're calling the right people at the right time, not necessarily the right time in the sales cycle, but within a reasonable moment. So we're not skewing the data with perfect answers and dials and terrible ones. So 100, perfect, nice round number we can work on. Now, this leads me on to the second thing I was going to query with you. Is that 100 people, is that 100 calls across the team, or is that 100 calls per individual?
Yeah, so I want to be very clear, not 100 calls, 100 connects.
Yeah.
Yeah, so connects. So I actually had the conversation. That would be for the team.
Sure. So how important then is it to spread this across the team? Versus just pull data from, well, we know Barry, Mary, and Sally are our best reps. If we can get them working, we can trickle this down to perhaps the slightly lower performing reps. Is that a strategy, or should we do this across the team so that the data is more accurate from an organizational standpoint?
Yeah, so it's very easy once you have these dispositions set up to create dashboards in Salesforce. And if everyone's using the same script, and if everyone's been trained on tonality, and everyone's been trained on diffusing objections, then what you can do is actually start to coach to good. And so you spread this out across the whole team, and you can see individual connect to conversion rate statistics, and you can also see it for the team. And if Mary is converting at 19% or 22%, and everybody else is converting at 9, well, we can now delve into that. Is it her tonality? Is she actually dialing more? Does she have better leads? Is she deviating off the script? If so, what is she doing differently so we can actually update it for the rest of the team? But you have to have those benchmarks and those scripts in place and absolutely distribute it throughout the whole team so you can actually coach people that are maybe not hitting the mark and give praise to people that are.